This is a Fox News alert. Hello, everyone. I'm Kimberly Guilfoyle, and a grand jury in Missouri has reached a decision on whether to indict Ferguson police officer Darren Wilson for the August shooting death of 18-year-old Michael Brown. An announcement is expected to come at any moment. Let's go live to Fox's Steve Harrigan with the very latest from outside the Justice Center in Clayton. Steve?
Kimberly, crowds really eagerly awaiting this announcement. This grand jury of 12 people has been working behind closed doors for the past 3 months, ever since the August shooting of 18-year-old Michael Brown. Now, within the next couple of hours, we expect an announcement whether or not they find it reasonable to bring criminal charges against Officer Darren Wilson. Now, back in August, we did see some violent unrest and large-scale protests. The real question is what's going to happen now after that announcement. It's 3 months later. Both sides have been meeting together, protesters and law enforcement. The temperature's certainly very different as well. Down in the 30s today, will we see the large-scale protests? Certainly law enforcement has been bracing for that. We've seen barricades set up. Public buildings, government buildings really blocked off, and a real tension in the air. Businesses once again boarding up, and when you talk to people on the street, a real sense of fear of what could happen following this announcement, an announcement we expect within the next 2 hours. Kimberly, back to you.
All right. Thanks, Steve, for that update. And this weekend, former New York City Mayor Rudy Giuliani got in a heated exchange over policing in black communities on Meet the Press with Georgetown professor Michael Eric Dyson. Watch.
I find it very disappointing that you're not discussing the fact that 93% of blacks in America are killed by other blacks. We're talking about the exception here.
First of all, most black people who commit crimes against other black people go to jail. Number two, they are not sworn by the police department as a agent of the state to uphold the law. So in both cases, that's a false equivalency that the mayor has drawn, which has exacerbated tensions that are deeply embedded in American culture.
Officers won't be there if you weren't killing each other.
Look at this.
Hang on.
The defensive mechanism of white supremacy at work in your minds.
Rudy appeared on Fox and Friends this morning to defend his stance.
I probably save more black lives as mayor of New York City than any mayor in the history of the city. I'd like to see if any of if Dr. Dyson has ever saved as many lives in his community as I've saved. The danger to a black child in America is not a white police officer. That's going to happen less than 1% of the time. The danger to a black child, if it was my child, the danger is another black.
Okay, so he's speaking from his perspective and considerable years of experience, not only as mayor of New York City, but as a former prosecutor working very closely with law enforcement, you know, in the streets of New York. Eric, what's your take?
My take is, Bob, you were huffing and puffing a little bit that Mayor Giuliani would say something like that, but the facts are, and the numbers bear them out, that black-on-black crime is the majority. Black men and women are dying at the hands of other black men and women at an alarming rate, 90-something percent, I believe he said, in New York City. Professor Dyson, and we must use that term loosely, did something unbelievable. I'm not sure if we caught that in the soundbite or not, but he actually said something about white supremacy and Rudy Giuliani at the end of that soundbite. Mm-hmm. If we didn't pull it, you go listen to it. It was one of the most egregious uses of race baiting I've heard in a long time, maybe ever. Giuliani's point was he put more cops on the street, he cleaned up Times Square, he took the crime off the street, and when the 90% of the crime plus is black on black, you're reducing the crime against black people. That's his point.
You know, he also closed my favorite massage parlor on Times Square. But,
the tragedy.
Terrible.
It was.
Jeez, really?
They were great. You were great. Deep
is that why
issues.
You're so cranky? Hey,
listen, I'm not cranky at all.
Not
what
yet.
Are you talking about? You'll make me cranky. It won't take long. But listen, the thing that bothered me with Giuliani said is white policemen would not be there if you didn't kill each other. Now, what is that all about?
Explain it.
Yeah, okay.
Explain it to me.
Because Professor Dyson says that when the police are in a city, he calls it an occupying force. If you apply that logic, you would remove that occupying force, and then what do you have is a community that is besieged by crime. The police are there to fight to protect the good from the bad. That is their role. They don't want to be there and cause problems, which is why, I mean, when Giuliani talks about creating a force that best reflects a community, that helps. The problem in places like Ferguson is they can't find enough applicants to be police officers in their own community. So you have a police department that doesn't look like Ferguson, and it happens in other cities as well. In the 1990s, New York City averaged 40 homicides a week. Many of those victims were minorities. In 2014, there were weeks when there wasn't a single murder in New York. So that meant now in 2014, those not being killed were minorities. So when Giuliani says that he's saved more lives than Dyson. He is making a factual statement. He is right. The police force has done more for minorities than any liberal program on the planet by simply letting them live. So it's an actual fact what Giuliani said. And Dyson calling the police an occupying force creates an idea that it is a presence that needs to be removed.
Right.
So what would Dyson's, what is Dyson's solution? Will Dyson go on the street and protect those businesses and those innocent families?
Well, I mean, I don't know Dyson, and I don't particularly have any interest in what he had to say there, but I will say this, that most of these murders in the black-on-black is drug-related,
yeah,
heavily drug-related. It's gang-related, and they're right. I mean, the numbers are right. 97% of blacks kill blacks. But I'm not sure I understand yet what the connection here is with Ferguson.
We got to get Danny here. Here, Bob. No, it wasn't really. They were talking about Ferguson. They were talking about black crime. Black crime. So if you reduce crime and 90% of the victims are black, are you not reducing black crime on black people?
Sure.
Rudy said that's what he did, and that's exactly what he did. It's not that. It wasn't that outrageous, and for Dyson to go ahead and say you have some sort of white supremacist mentality to Rudy Giuliani is absolutely asinine. It's not even. I mean, black people in New York should be thrilled that Rudy Giuliani did what he did.
Mm-hmm.
Not angry, as Dyson is somehow trying to turn it into an anger thing. It wasn't.
Sorry. Anna,
I think that one of the things we've been talking about over the past several years, where race is almost a topic daily on this program, but partly because that's in the news and people are stoking it, but it's also a real issue we have to talk about. There's no question that safer communities are more successful communities. How do you get to a safe community? First of all, is security. Then you've got to look at education, marriage rates, employment. And then public service. All of those things matter. And a place like Ferguson, tonight I hope that they can get through whatever the decision is in a peaceful way. Understand that there are people going to be unhappy no matter what happens. I am surprised, Kimberly, that they are making this announcement so late in the day, in the dark. I mean, it'll be after dark. I don't know what. Maybe there's a good reason for it. I don't understand why they wouldn't have made it very early in the morning and let people assemble then in the daylight. I think that probably would have been better.
That's exactly right. Most of all this rioting that took place there took place at night, if we remember, and under the cover of darkness is when people from outside that community come in and agitate. I'd be very curious to see how many people are down there sort of hiding out, ready to jump in the middle of this.
But perhaps nothing to do with Ferguson. Was just made, and so this is why the timing is such.
There are four elements in this conflict. There are legitimate protesters who sincerely believe that there's an injustice and they should be out there and their voices should be heard. There's law enforcement that have to respond in case there's any trouble. There are concerned businessmen that are out there that are businesses that are afraid that maybe they might lose something and they have. And then there's the fourth group, which is there specifically to get those other three groups to destroy each other. These are radicals that know the path to anarchy is by creating racial conflict. They don't care about Ferguson. They don't care. They're just there to inflame so that they can have their revolution. And this has happened again and again with these outside groups coming in. The sad part about it is it does hurt legitimate protesters who really do care and law enforcement who make mistakes and who also care as well.
Can I add a fifth group? Mm-hmm. Average citizens. Probably 90% of the people in the area are the average citizens who don't own a business, who aren't law enforcement and who aren't going to protest tonight. And they're just sitting there waiting. They're just waiting by the door, praying that you know, evil doesn't knock on their door.
Then you have people who are taking advantage of the situation, Eric, that are coming in from the outside to stir the pot.
Absolutely.
Can I ask Kimberly something from a legal standpoint? So, as Steve Harrigan reported, and we've been reporting on Fox News, the grand jury's been meeting for about 3 months. In your experience as a prosecutor, is that an average amount of time to present evidence in a case like this? Or has it gone on longer than you would have expected?
No, actually, I think this has taken about the amount of time that I would expect, given some of the complexities of this particular case and the different forensic reports and reports from criminologists as well. So let's see what happens. They don't just hear one case at a time.
Yeah, they take out multiple cases, right?
Right, there's multiple cases. So in addition, you have this case, and they take them all and give them appropriate time.
I got a question for you, Counselor, as well. I think that Ferguson's or the family's lawyer made a good point when he said, for 20 years, a prosecutor has not gone in there and, like this guy said, I'm not going to take a position. In other words, we are not taking a position. Here's the evidence. Usually, always prosecutors go in and say, we want an indictment, right? But he's not doing that. And not, why is that?
Well, you can go at the end. You can make a summation and give your side of it and say, this is what we think, you know, the evidence can show. But you put it up to the grand jury. I mean, I don't know how he knows exactly what went on in there because it's, you know, secret proceedings. So I'm not sure where he's coming from in that regard. But nevertheless, they also, when they give their verdicts, they render that. That's anonymous as well. So other people may not know on the grand jury exactly how it's going to go down. And then, of course, the defense also the person who is the target of the grand jury will also be allowed the opportunity to present any evidence if they choose
But the prosecutors go in there and say, we think this is enough evidence.
And the grand jury, as I've done, well, you go forward, you bring them, but I don't tell them, I think you should come back and give a second degree implied malice or whatever. When I did my last one that I did before I left the DA's office, the dog mauling case, I didn't go in there and say, I think you should find for a second degree. I said, here's all the facts. Here's the evidence. These are the charges available to you. Grand jury came back and asked for a second degree instruction because they felt that the evidence rose.
I mean, you got to have sympathy for a jury when the specter of rioting is used as leverage, that you know that perhaps if you make the right decision, you will create hell, and maybe you should make the wrong decision to save lives. And it's disturbing in a country of 317 million people where thousands of crimes are committed every day. The media puts its collective magnifying glass right here in this small town. And when you put a magnifying glass on something, underneath things burn because it's a self-fulfilling prophecy. The more people that go there, it's a snowball. It builds velocity in mass. And there's no way the media, there's no way that anybody wants to slow it down because they have too much invested in this event.
And you know who are probably at the crosshairs of all this, bad term, I shouldn't use that, who are at the middle of all this are the cops. The cops realize that if violence breaks out, protest is right. Protest is protected in the Constitution, peaceful protest. But when it goes beyond peaceful protest, they have to step up. With all the media attention that the cops are getting in Ferguson, boy, are we tying one hand behind their back? Because if they see something that they should be doing and they're going to say, well, wait, this is going to be interpreted the wrong way, and they let something go, they have the toughest job of anyone tonight.
Just like the military with the rules of engagement now that have been so hampering their ability and they're second-guessing themselves.
This also keep in mind, there's a large percentage of the black community in Ferguson made up their minds. They don't care what the verdict, what the grand jury is going to do. They've decided that they thought it was murder.
I mean, we can just only hope that the people respect the process and understand that this was put forward to a grand jury for them to decide based on all the facts and evidence. And none of us here at this table or really out there have it. The grand jury had it all in front of them, so let's hope that people respect the process. And once again, a decision has been reached by a grand jury on the shooting of Michael Brown in Ferguson, and we are expecting an announcement very shortly, so please stay with us. Coming up next, an unexpected resignation from a top member of the president's cabinet today. Was Defense Secretary Chuck Hagel forced out? Well, we're going to tell you what our sources are telling us. That's ahead.